one to, we had a good prayer Monday night too.
Did you?
What we're beginning to do in prayer, beginning to.
Definitely, yeah.
We're beginning to speak for the words of the word, the words of the Bible. We are focusing on trying to get more people into the church and trying to rescue people because it's too late. We feel that the time is very short and what we must do, we must do it very quickly. And we have to kind of build ourselves up, get out of this bashfulness. Sometimes we are afraid to fight people or talk to people or give them our testimony. Sometimes we just don't, you know, feel capable of doing it. Sometimes we feel like we're not, capable. We're not worthy. Sometimes we're not talk well enough or whatever. But we got to get out of all of this and realize that we're labors together with Him. So God has that kept us to do whatever He has called us to do. And we want to consistently acknowledge what God is in us. And that's the secret of boldness and confidence. If you want to be bold, I think Glo is pretty bold. She talks out even when I'm talking on stuff.
Yeah.
So she's bold. Amen. She ain't scared.
All
right.
Getting out of it.
Okay. So in prayer, this is the way that we can get great strength when we begin to acknowledge who we are in Christ. This really makes the prayer meaning really rich and full and complete. And many times we have just hollered out, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." That's you acknowledging that, that it's God that's working in you, causing you to be whatever you are and to do whatever you are able to do. So we always want to stick with scriptures that shows God's ability, that expresses God's ability within us. That really gives us boldness and confidence in our prayer. And it makes prayer really exciting because whenever you confess that God is in me and He's greater than all. But sometimes you hear me say, "I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me." So that's what prayer should be, taking the words that God has given us and speaking those words back to God and confessing those words boldly in the environment wherever we are. So people can hear that. And when people hear that, then the scripture says the humble shall hear that and they shall be glad. So we can create whatever type of environment in prayer that we want to, but you got to do it with words. It's got to be words that acknowledge who God is and what He has done and the things that God is doing through us. So since the next chapter we're going to be studying about being followers of Christ, following the example of Jesus. And did you know that Jesus consistently confessed what God was doing through Him? He was confessing who His relationship with God. Remember Jesus said things like this, "Me and my Father are one."
Yes. Even though He said He spent in wilderness.
Amen. All right. Okay, so 3 days, He said 3 days. Okay, but He always confessed who He was. And you always want to confess what God has made you in Him. Amen. And that's the key. You see me, you see my Father. Amen. So when we get to the point where you tell people, "When you see me, you see my Father." In other words, the life that's projected through me is going to be a direct reflection of what God is all about. Amen. So we you want to, y'all listen very carefully, you want to build a vocabulary of faith in your prayer. Otherwise, prayer is not going to be worth the time. If you just kind of, you know, fumble around and try to remember what the old folks used to say. Sometimes they didn't have the revelation that we have today, but we always want to confess what God is to us. And the more we confess that, then the more that becomes reality in our lives. Because, but if you don't confess anything, if you don't say anything, then nothing will happen. We create the word of the universe that we have. Whatever we enjoy, our experience, is going to be the result of the things that we speak. Amen. So since we believe that we can do nothing of ourselves, how many believe that we can't do anything of ourselves? All of our sufficiency is of Him. All right, so if you can remember that, Father, all of my sufficiency is of You. What's wrong with saying that to God? Well, He already knows it, but He wants you to know it. I mean, in reality, you know, we might say it, but He wants us to really know, right, that our sufficiency is of Him. And the more you speak faith-building words like that, these are life-giving words, then the more life you're going to find that's going to be released into your life. So my prayer is always built around speaking whatever I can remember that really magnifies God and really reflects what God is doing through me. And when I begin to agree with God and confess those things, then it really does something for the man on the inside. It really does something for me. So the next chapter, as I was getting ready to say, is that God wants us to know that the works that Jesus did, He did them independent of His position as God. He did it as a man. That's the reason why Jesus laid aside all of His outward powers, His mighty power and glory, laid it aside, and He came down in the form of a what? A man. So He wanted us to realize that everything that He did it as a what? Man, anointed by who? Anointed by the Holy Spirit. So that was the example He set, because Jesus Himself said, He said that I can do nothing of myself. My God is not what?
My Father.
You see, it's my Father that doeth the works what? Through me. And that's the what? And I don't know whether it's 5 cents, it might be right, but it's in Judge. It's in Judge for sure. Y'all can check her out. Okay, but, and this morning I was really inspired. I say, I want to be able to extract as many scriptures as I can to make it so obvious and real in my life that it's not me that's responsible for what making everything happen.
Mm-hmm.
It's me what just submitting and surrendering to what the Lord, and let Him what do stuff through me. Okay, so if the scripture says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with what? The Holy Ghost, and with what? Power, who went about doing good, healing all of those that were oppressed. See, Jesus didn't take the credit for doing nothing of Himself. He said, everything I do is not me, it's the Father that's doing all of these things what? Through me. So you want to know, and you want to have the consciousness and the awareness that if you really submit to God and place yourself at God's disposal, God will do great things through you. Amen. Your strength is not capable of accomplishing what God wants to accomplish through you. But you have to realize that what is not me, just like Paul said, it's not me any longer. It's the what? Christ that lives in me. He's the one that was doing all of these things through me. So when we can come to the point where we acknowledge that we are not about anything, but God is what? Amen. He's what? He's all in all. Then God will what? Show Himself as what? As God and God alone. I mean, he'll show off. If you come to the point where, Lord, I ain't about nothing. I can't do nothing. I'm not sufficient in myself. But amen, it's you that what? Doeth the works through me. So that really challenged me for me to become as nothing as I can. So God can become what? All that he wants to be. Amen. When you can come to that point, when you completely lean in and depend in and trust in him, then he will what? Show himself strong.
Amen.
So,
will Jesus come?
So, I have some scriptures. You can write these down. These are scriptures that's designed to help you in prayer because we get ready to study chapter 3. And we talk about Moses, and Moses was a great man of God, and he was a man of prayer. But all great men of prayer, they follow the same example. They always acknowledge the what? The power and the anointing of God that's working in them. Amen. And most times, they will admit that whatever God is doing through them, you know, is not the results of their limited what? Strength or their limited knowledge. It's God. How many remember when Joseph was called upon to interpret that dream that who dreamed? Who dreamed that dream? Pharaoh dreamed that dream, right? Okay? Nobody would know. I mean, the only person that was able to do that, to interpret it, was Joseph. And when it came to Joseph, Joseph said, it's not in me to interpret this dream.
That's right.
What did he mean by that? Interpretation is not of me. Interpretation comes from what? From God. So they always acknowledged that they weren't about nothing, but they what? They trusted in God to do whatever needed to be done. And it was the same thing with Daniel. And Daniel, you know, all of those wise men were about to be what? Killed? And they came to Daniel, and they were about to kill him and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And Daniel said, if you give me 3 days to interpret the dream, I'm going to just ask, amen, of the Lord and just see what God will do. Amen. He said that. The interpretation is of what? It's of God. He acknowledged that what? He couldn't do it, but he said, I know of God in heaven. Amen. I know of God that is in heaven, and he knows what? He knows all of the secrets. And he always trusted God to what? To work through him and bring about his purpose, amen, through his life. Amen. So I was thinking this morning, I say, Lord, I wish we could come to the point where we could just become free in our prayer life, where we can consistently acknowledge God's ability and really begin to speak those things that would be not, and call those things that be not as though they were, though they are. Amen. So we got to learn how to what? Agree with God in our prayer life to make our prayer life very powerful. Now here's a scripture that I use a lot. I said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. This is Luke 4:18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Now sometimes people are afraid to say stuff like that. Because they say, well, I don't know whether the Spirit of the Lord is on me a little big. I don't know whether it's the, you know, it's in the right measure. I don't know. I feel something sometimes. But I'm kind of scared to say the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. But we need to acknowledge what God has made us and what God is consistently doing through us. Now, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has what? Anointed me to do what? Preach the gospel to the poor. He has what? Sent me to what? Heal the brokenhearted and to what? Preach deliverance. Amen. So we need to confess in prayer sometimes. Even sometimes when you make declarations, Monday night when you're just making declarations out loud, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me. That makes you feel good. That brings in the anointing. He has anointed me to preach the gospel. Amen. So that means that when you can get scriptures like that thoroughly implanted in your spirit, then you're not going to have a drawback spirit when the door is open for you to what? Talk to somebody. For you to share your testimony or your experience with somebody. So the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has what? Anointed me. How many will say, I am anointed? Are we scared to say it?
No. That's
what Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is, he couldn't do anything of himself. He said, but the Spirit of the Lord is what? Upon me, and he has what? Anointed me to preach the gospel. So we are anointed to preach or to teach, amen, the gospel to the poor. Amen. We are anointed. If you open your mouth wide, amen, cooperate with the Lord, amen, that anointing will be released through your mouth, and you're going to bless somebody and give you, amen, amen, submit to God. Amen. All of those things that the Spirit of the Lord is upon us to do, we need to confess them consistently in prayer. And I've made a habit of just saying it in prayer, because prayer time, you know, there's no point in just sitting there twiddling your thumbs. You know, sometimes people just think, you know, I can't think of nothing to say. I remember the old school, back at home, people used to say the same thing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. But I found out that there's more power in prayer, saying or affirming the word of God, than just saying what? The same thing over and over. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he hath anointed me. I'm anointed. You can just say it any way you want. I'm anointed to preach the gospel. I'm anointed to help people. I'm anointed to touch people's lives. I'm anointed to share with people. Amen. So that is a good scripture that you can make part of your prayer vocabulary. Everybody said prayer vocabulary.
Prayer.
Amen. The jaguar, the little picnic. Yeah, the little guy, little small, they call him a midget. I'll say midget. He has the big, tall guy. What makes you so tall and strong? I want to be strong and tall like you. And the giant told the little midget, he said, it's the giant talk. If you want to get big, you got to learn how to what? Talk the giant talk. The giant talk is what? The word of God. You want to grow, you got to what? Talk the Amen. You know, I heard yesterday on TV, they was talking about people that eat dairy. How many eat dairy? All right. He said that eating dairy makes little calves become big cows. Make the little calves big cows. If you keep eating dairy, then the little calves will become what? A big cow. I thought that was pretty good. And that meant to a couple of things too, if you keep eating all that fat. You become a big cow. Oh, Jesus. So I got a lesson out of that. Okay, now, St. John 14:10. Now, this is the vocabulary that will grow on you. And if you're in prayer meeting, you're going to hear me say these things. You know, anytime it pops in my mind, I'm going to let it come out. Because when it comes out, it makes me feel real good all over. It makes me very happy. It says, the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the work. The Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the work. Now, how can a scripture like that impact you? I don't want anybody to say that. How can a simple scripture? Now, a lot of times we say things like this, it doesn't mean anything to a lot of people. Amen. But when I say, the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. That really gives me a special anointing. It impacts me. Amen. How could that mean anything to anybody?
It means the Father. It's the Father that does the work. We don't have to be concerned about us doing the works because the Father's going to do it.
Amen, because most time we feel like we're not up to par, right?
Yeah.
We feel like we're substandard, we're too, we're too awkward, or we've messed up. And we've been through a whole lot of stuff, and we feel like we're not worthy, yeah, right? But when you begin to say, the Father that dwelleth in me, gives me two measures, and let me know that the Father is in me. And whenever you acknowledge
the
14:10.
Okay.
The Father that's in me, he's the one that what? That when you acknowledge that, then he's gonna what? He's gonna do more work.
Yes.
He's gonna what? He's gonna show himself what? Strong. Amen. Just like telling your wife, Sister Hill always said that. She said that I want you to say every day that I love you. She said, you want me to say it every day? And this is the lesson, dear sister, for you, I said. Well, I told you several months ago that I love you, and it still stands.
she said that's
well and good, but I want to hear it every day. Amen. She wants to be acknowledged as being what? Me, as being loved. She wants to, amen, me to say that what? That I love her. So that's an acknowledgement that what? That love is what? Amen. It's present here. Amen. So the more I acknowledge that, then the more that impacts her. She feels more aware of my, and more conscious of my what? My abiding love in her life. So saying things consistently really means a difference, makes a difference. How many can say amen?
Amen.
And when God hears us consistently acknowledge that he's the one that's doing the work, he's going to make sure that work is going to be what? Amen. A good work, right? He's going to make that thing what? Amen. As good as it can be. Hallelujah. Amen. So, but here's the thing that kind of makes me sad sometimes, y'all. We can go through a prayer meeting and you won't have to hear anybody say anything that magnifies God in this respect. They won't say anything. It's the Father that's in me. He's the one that's what? Doing the work. Praise the Lord. And can you say praise the Lord ahead of that?
Yes.
Amen. I mean, that can even get you into the spirit. Mix it all up together. It's the Father that's in me. Woo! I mean, you can even add that in. Woo! make it exciting. Make your prayer life exciting. Amen. We're going to build a vocabulary that will magnify God and cause us to rejoice.
Why don't we learn the song all together in this class?
Okay, well, we're going to be singing
some. 21 Freedom.
Okay, well, we're going to sing some spirit song. Everybody's going to have to learn that. Everybody can sing their own spirit song.
We get up and sing.
Okay, now, St. John 14:10, what does that say now?
The Father that dwells in me,
yes.
Amen. Now, if you hear me pray long enough, you're going to hear me come around and say something like that. It's the Father, Father, it's you and me. Amen. Now, sometimes you can even switch to things like this if you can remember. Some of you might be still enough. You remember Paul said, Father, I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but it's not me, but it's the Christ that lives in me. You can say, Lord, it's not me that live. I mean, you can just add that in. If you're familiar with that, you can just say, well, it's not me that live, but it's the what? Christ that lives in me. That magnifies what? That magnifies Jesus. Well, he gets happy. He starts grinning. Amen. He starts rejoicing. He probably starts dancing. Hey! It's the Father that's in me. It's him that's what? Doing the work. It's not me any longer, but it's you, Father, that what? It's the Christ that what? Liveth in me.
Amen.
Hey, hallelujah. And it keeps on, Sister Pearl, the life that I used to live in. I live it now by the faith of what? The Son of God who loved me and gave his life for me. Amen. That's Galatians 1. That's not like Galatians 7. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. That means that you don't have to keep your own self sane. Mm-hmm. For a long time, I just wouldn't get saved until I was 21. I wanted to have all the fun I could before I just, made a decision to what? To walk the straight and narrow path. I wanted to do all the devil meant I could. Get it all out of the way. So I could, amen, when I got settled in the Lord, I knew I could do no more. But I used to feel that it would be a real struggle trying to live a godly life. But when I got saved and found out that it's no more me, that I'm not even capable of what pleasing God, walking worthy of the Lord. But my ability is not of myself. My ability is of Him. And I found out that I can do all things through who? Christ. That what? I can do all things. Amen. You find that scripture in Galatians? Galatians 2:20. All right, y'all write that down. Galatians 2:20. Amen. These are scriptures that we want to really begin to get meditate, and we want to begin to speak them. And it's going to make us feel like giants, spiritual giants. Whereas you felt like you were not capable because you haven't been saved. Amen. As long as Pastor Hill has, and sometimes we back off and say, well, I ain't got enough going to, talk to so-and-so or to get this one on the right track. But we have to realize that our sufficiency is not of us. Our sufficiency is of Him. And the more you acknowledge that, then the more you will see God work through you, His will and the ability to carry out all that He asks us to do. All right, but both of the scriptures now, Luke 4:18, St. John 14:10, and Sister Pearl gave us Galatians what? 2:20. Amen. Now, suppose you would increase your vocabulary with expressions like this until your vocabulary is contained at least 100 scriptures. You could pray a really exciting prayer. I mean, you start praying, you never won't stop. You would never want to stop. Because the more you acknowledge God is at work in me, He's doing the work, then the more He's going to work in you. Amen. So we got 3 or 4 scriptures on that our belt now. I'm going to give you one more, St. John 8:28, and that is a real good one. St. John 8:28. Amen. These are scriptures that I'm building into my spirit because I want to be able to pull them up with my prayer. I don't plan my prayer. I don't even know what I'm going to say. But all of these things are in me, and they're stored away. And whenever the right time for them to what come forward, the Holy Spirit is going to what help me to regurgitate it. He's going to help me to what go down and pull it out. And that's the thing that will what put you on cloud 13. You know what I mean, Brother William? Cloud 13?
No.
Y'all tell me what I mean when I say put you on cloud 13.
When you heard, it's just automatically when you read it over and over and over. There it is.
All right, Sister White, cloud
13. Up there with you. That's up there.
That's right. Because the Bible says that, what kind of word makes the heart stoop? The wrong word will make the heart stoop, make you feel down and discouraged. But a good word will make your heart what? Glad again. Good words will what? Make your heart glad and pluck you up out of that state of despondency and put you on cloud 13. A good word. So you got to have something good come out of your mouth. That's the thing that what builds the spirit man up.
Put you on 13.
Yeah, cloud 13. Yes, glory. Okay. St. John 8:20. I'm not sure whether I am quoted as
second.
St. John 8:20, I do nothing of myself. I do nothing of myself. Amen. So sometimes in prayer, I'll say, Lord, I do nothing of myself. Amen. That ministers to me because it shows me that I really am not really what capable of making things that God wants me to do. I'm not capable in myself of what making those things happen in my life. But when God is in me, when God is in me doing the work, then you don't have to be all under all of that pressure trying to what? Make God's word, amen, work. Let God work the word, right? You kind of sit on the back row. I mean, things you can do is what? Praise the Lord. And you can acknowledge what God is saying. Lord, I do nothing. I mean, you can say that, right? And that will what? That will put God in what? In place for him to what? Start working. But when you say, Lord, I got all the answers. I don't need Sister Wayne. I don't need nobody. Hey, amen. So you always want to stay humble before God and acknowledge what is God that makes us all that we are. You know, there's a scripture which says that I am what I am. I am what I am. You know, the world got this quotation, well, it is what it is. That's not where it is. That's not where it is.
That reminds me of the Ten Commandments when Moses went up on the mountain.
You're right.
And then came the Spirit with God. He said, God said, I am what I am.
Yeah, I am who I am. All right.
Thou shalt put no one before me.
Right. Thou shalt put no other God before me. All right, Brother William, pull one back up, brother. Oh, yeah. You got some word in it, man. Y'all listen to it. You got some word in it, man. He needs to come and get a little bit more, though. All right. I am what I am because of the grace of God.
Amen.
Y'all don't know how many times I say that in prayer. And when I say that, I usually go out in tongues. Oh, Rabbi Shunda. Sometimes I just say, Holy Asata. Amen. See, the word of God got a lot of power in it. If we would what? Affirm it. Amen. This is what God is saying to us. He wants us to what? Agree with him in the word. He wants us to what? Say it out. Say it back to him. Amen. Yeah. Say it back to him. That's how the word gets established in our heart, by what? Saying it out loud. Don't be silent. Don't be quiet.
I am
what I am because of the grace of God. And sometimes I top it off. I'm just nice and okay. His grace is sufficient. Hey! Hey! That really gets me happy. His grace is what? Sufficient for me. I said that so many times. His grace is sufficient for me. Hey, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
I'm
going to get Sister Pearl to type them all out.
Okay.
Because this is just the scriptures in one category. And the other category.
I always got them.
All right, now, in that same verse, let's still read that same verse. I do always these things that please him. It's somewhere in there. St. John 8:28.
Yes,
yeah, we are going to the same doctor to get a kneecap.
Oh.
other golf courses.
I know all the stuff I've done, but my God, he's there now. All I got to worry about.
All right, he's there now, all right.
But still, now, you, in 29, he said something that I always do those things, and he's, and he that sent me is with me, the Father that not have not left me alone, for I do always those things that please.
Ooh, that makes a whole lot of
sense. Yes. This is the next verse.
Oh, okay.
29.
Read 29 to the case this morning.
And he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him.
Y'all put both those verses together.
Yes.
Boy, you're going to have a shouting good time. I mean, just on the verses we've given you so far.
Yeah.
Just think, I got a whole bunch of them more that I won't get to. And we're going to get some prayer to type them all up. But if you just spend some time meditating these scriptures and speaking them back to God, amen, you're going to find that you're going to build into your spirit a fire. Amen. A fire that will never be able to be quenched. And you will never be challenged and limited in prayer again. Because I believe it's better to build a vocabulary and begin to what? Agree with God and just continually in prayer, just to speak out all of these things that we are talking about today. Just speak them out. And that's the only way the Word of God will ever become real to us anyway. You got to what? You got to affirm it. That's the thing that I'm trying to really establish in this church. If we can have 25 or 30 people that can perfect this, I mean, this church would be on fire. And I would hardly be able to preach in some churches.
Probably not.
Anointing would be so strong. Everybody would feel like they are what? They are somebody.
That's right.
More than conquerors. Yeah. In all of these things, we are what? More than conquerors through him that what loved us and gave himself for us. Amen. Praise God. Now, there is another scripture, St. John 10:30. See, the book of St. John is just full of
expressions.
Jesus just said these things, and he always said whatever that pertains to his relationship with his Father. He said things like this: I am the true vine.
I am the vine, and you are the branches.
Yeah, and you
and
are
my Father.
That's the 15. St. John 15. That's the 10th verse first, because this 15, we might just get hung up there for a while. The glow is already all right, trying to get ahead of me. She's trying to get me to the...
No.
All right, St. John 10:30.
You know, bow is a tiger.
All right, St. John 10:30. Let's see what we can get out of this. St. John 10:30. Somebody read that.
I and my Father are one.
All right, now, I and my Father are what? One. Add this scripture, she says.
That is a
shepherd. I and my Father are one. Okay, now, what do you get out of that? I and my Father are one.
I
said
the same thing my Father
said. Yeah, he does.
All right.
He can't do anything but when his Father.
That means his strength is what? Mine. His word is what? Mine. His ability is mine. His life is mine. Yes, hallelujah. All that he's all about is what? It's all mine. That means the same life that flows out of the vine, what flows in me. Amen.
It's like
He's the vine, and we are the what? Branch. We are the branches. How many know if you had a vine, and that vine had a whole lot of branches, what could you say about that vine and branch relationship? What do you know about the relationship between the vine and the branch?
As a branch, if it wasn't for that vine, that vine, then it wouldn't be done.
If it wasn't for the vine. That's right. So what will we? All right, you got a lot going, flowing, huh?
Yeah.
All right, so the same life force that's flowing to that vine, it has to flow to the what? The branches. For the branches to what? Produce.
By the tree.
Mm-hmm.
By the water.
Yeah, okay.
Sounds wise.
You're like a tree planted by
the water.
That bringing forth its fruit in its season. We also shall not perish, whatever we do, shall prosper. That same kind of relationship. Okay, let's turn to the Bible. The one everybody is turning to 15:5. 15. Let's do St. John 15. We need to read several scriptures there. Let's see what we can extract out of that. I and my Father are one. Amen. That means that whatever he had, whatever he's about, whatever strength I need, whatever direction or wisdom I need, it all comes what?
From him.
It all comes from him. So when we begin to acknowledge it, Lord, my wisdom is of you. My ability is of you. My peace is of you. My joy is of you. Of myself, I can do what?
Nothing.
My sufficiency is all of you. Amen. How many can understand that if we can build a good, strong vocabulary affirming what God is and who he is and what he is to us, brother, we will be able to pray and enjoy rich fellowship with God, and nothing would be impossible. Okay? St. John 15:1. Let's read 4 or 5 or 6 verses there. Let's see what we can get out of that.
I am the true vine, and my Father has the husband in it. Every branch in me that bears not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that bears fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing.
All right. So what is that scripture? What do y'all get out of that? Y'all tell me what y'all get out of that.
Hold on.
Okay, so this is what you said.
Hold on to it.
I want to bear much fruit
for the Lord.
Okay, but you can't bear much fruit unless you what? You got to stay. Stay in the land. That means fellowship.
I stay with him.
But you got to stay connected, right?
If you stay connected,
you're going to what? You're going to be able to what? Abide in the vine, and you're going to be able to draw life, strength, peace, joy, victory, whatever, healing. All of that is in the vine. How many believe that? And we just said the word is the vine, right?
Yeah, the vine will be
without him, my life would
a ship without a sail. That sound pretty good, Flo?
Yeah, I like it.
All right. All right, you like my singing, you like the song. All right, I got you.
I like the singing. I got you. I love singing when I first come to church.
Okay, now this is the, somebody else, what did you get out of that passage?
Was that him, the song you just sang?
No, the 5 or 6 verses that we mentioned about.
Oh, out of all of them? Hold on to your faith. Hold on to God's word. Let nothing distract you, because if so, the eternal life going to be turned around.
All right.
It's
going to
be crooked.
All right. So I boil it down. Jesus is the vine. Jesus is in me. He's the vine. And I'm the branch. And he abideth in me. And I abide in him. And if I abide in him, I bring forth much fruit. Without him, I can do but nothing. All right, in other words, the same life. This is one saying, okay, go ahead.
I just had a visual of.
Right.
But you finished what you were. But I was thinking about my little plants at home.
Okay, go ahead.
And the little leaves and everything that right. come off that little plant.
Right.
Now, sometimes they die. And fall or start turning and can produce nothing, but as long as it stays healthy, stays in the Word, I'm in the Word, I'm, you know, staying in communication, and I'm putting myself as that little plant, staying and eating off of the food that, like, the plant gets, or the Word of God is food to us. As we feed on that.
Right.
I'm strong and I'm staying in the Word and part with God. The Word is God. So I'm in fellowship with God. So then what the vine, the Word produces in me will life and health. And then when it's in me, then I can share. If I share that, you know, because the plant, it don't just stay the one or two. It continues to grow.
There you go.
And produce.
Mm-hmm.
And so as long as I stay with God and with the Word and fellowship with the Holy Spirit, then I'm to produce. I'll continue to produce and grow as I take that, what I'm getting, and share it. It just doesn't stay in the part of the leaf. It starts producing other little,
there you go. There you
other
go.
Little
right.
parts
right.
with it
right.
and flourishing.
Right.
As long as I stay a part of that. But now, if I decide that I want to go off, well then, you know, I won't be producing not that pretty plant. It'll be death when the little parts fall off. So
right.
it's staying, you know, that I am. You know, he said he is, and we stay with him
right.
and believe in him and the Father, you know, that, you know, it continue to bring forth fruit.
Jackson, we really see Sunday, those girls came in?
Yeah.
You come up with them?
Yeah, he came down.
All right. I can't wait till Sister Cynthia gets that.
They see the good coming out of her. They see it.
Yeah.
They
see something happening. That's the assignment, y'all look it up. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in me. I write it down so you can find out my sound. And I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. We have that one already. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me.
Philippians, Philippians 4:4.
You sure?
Philippians 4:4.
I can do all things through Christ.
Yes, sir.
All right. Now write that down, make sure. I do all things through Christ that strengthens me. And God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power and love and a sound mind. God has not given me the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. I think that's Timothy, 1 Timothy or 2 Timothy. All of these scriptures are focusing very heavily on God's ability working in us. God's ability working is. All right? 2 Timothy 1:7. God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of what?
Power.
And of love. And of what? Sound man. Yeah, 2 Timothy 1:7. Okay, I have to look up some of those that I didn't have the scripture for. I can do all things through Christ. That's not all that Corinthians. Glow said,
Second.
I'm going to see what's at Philippians 4:4. Glow, you better be there. Philippians 4:4. That's rejoice in the Lord always.
Oh, in Colossians 1:4.
I can do all things through Christ. That's true. How many will agree that all of these scriptures are very powerful? And if we would just say them repeatedly, it will cause God's ability to rise up within us. Alright? Alright, so we want you all to begin practicing these scriptures. And as you practice them, you praise the Lord along with what? Your confession. Praise the Lord for speak, pray in tongues. You want to sing in the spirit? Just mix it all up together.
It's y'all understand John what I'm 5:19.
Saying?
John 5:19. What'd you say?
John 5:19.
What'd you say? I can do all things? Oh, we're not on that one.
No, that's the one we can't find.
Okay, well, I just found it. I tell you the truth. The Son can do nothing? No. Oh, okay.
Okay. All right, y'all finished.
Yeah.
All right, we're ready to go. Amen. But we want you all to begin to speak these things to God and just see what will happen. And just see how it's going to build you up and to give you a whole lot more freedom and liberty in prayer. Next week when we come back, we're going to spend the first few minutes in prayer. And y'all can be saying these things to the Lord as we pray. And I don't want to hear silence. I don't want to hear silence. I want to see y'all hear y'all mumbling something. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Y'all be mumbling something. Mumbling these words to God. That's the thing that's going to turn your life, amen, completely, completely around. Amen. It's going to be a big blessing. All right, brother. Amen. Brother William, we appreciate that. You do good to hang an hour and 15 minutes.
Yeah, real good.
And we want to encourage you to join us. We want to make you a regular on Wednesday. All right, so.
Never know.
You never know. All right, so we'll see. Then try to get Brother Wesley here. Okay, now, that's an assignment for you, okay? Get Brother Wesley. If you get Brother Wesley here.
I ain't
going there. Well, wait a minute. I can do all things. I can do all things.
I can do all things. But I can't move that.
I can do all things. Greater is he. See, it's not you that's going to move it. It's what is the God in you that will do it. So we have to look at God as the one that doeth the work, right?
That's right.
Amen. Greater is he that is in us than he that is what? In the world. Amen. Praise God. God in me is more than enough. God in me is more than enough. And it's all standing. Hey, Lord, I'm on Sunday.
That reminds me, I was out there picking guns at the church.
Right.
And this woman come out there. What you doing in this yard picking even guns? So, but God said I could pick them because he put these trees in.
Oh,
yeah. God on them, everything anyway.
Well,
he is letting us use.
All right, the same boldness you exercise there. Exercise it and get Brother Elam here, right? Tell him that it'll be a joy. It'll happen. Right?
Get me
birds.
Agree with God now. Agree with God. Amen.
I can do all of it.
Captain TV in here.
Okay.
He'll be here.
Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence. With exceeding great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. All right, next week when we come back, we want to...